Hey, it's me, Mahogany Silverain, of the Mahogany Says podcast on Anchor FM. If you haven't heard about Anchor, it is the easiest way to make a podcast. Let me explain. First, it's free. Second, there's creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or computer. Anchor will distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many more. You can make money from your podcast as well with no minimum listenership. It's everything you need to make a podcast in one place. So what are you waiting for? Download the free Anchor app on your phone or go to anchor.fm to get started today. You are listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silverain, mahoganysilverain.net. And for some reason, that's not working. So,
hey, it's me, Mahogany Silverain, of the Mahogany Says podcast on Anchor FM. If you haven't heard about Anchor, it is the easiest way to make a podcast. Let me explain. First, it's free. Second, there's creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or computer. Anchor will distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many more. You can make money from your podcast as well with no minimum listenership. It's everything you need to make a podcast in one place. So what are you waiting for? Download the free Anchor app on your phone or go to anchor.fm to get started today.
From author Mahogany Silverain comes the book, Tell Me You Love Me. Tell Me You Love Me is a paranormal and diverse romance novella. This is the first book in the Kenya Clark series. Breaking the laws of magic, a supernatural serial killer is unleashed on the city of Atlanta, Georgia. Special Agent Kenya Clark of the GBI Paranormal Crimes Investigation Unit has been given the case. Her partner hates anything to do with the supernatural. Kenya has a gift that allows her to see the crime through the eyes of the victim. However, in this case, she sees through the eyes of the killer. To solve the case, she must find out where her connection to the killer is. But will she and her partner be able to work together? Tell Me You Love Me from author Mahogany Silverain is available on Amazon in both Kindle and paperback editions, as well as the author's website, mahoganysilverain.net. Tell Me You Love Me from author Mahogany Silverain. Order your copy today.
Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silverain, mahoganysilverain.net.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining me on the Mahogany Says Show. I'm your host, Mahogany Silverain, and we've got a great show for you this evening. I hope everyone is doing well. I have a great author who I've been talking to, and I saw her book. I also bought it, and it's a real inspiration and blessing from what I have been reading, and I could relate to the story and relate to things that she went through. But I'll introduce her to you. Her name is Frances Dupree. Now, Frances, do you prefer to for me to call you Minister Dupree or just Frances?
No, you can just call me Frances. Thank you.
Okay. Well, say hello to everyone.
How you doing, Frances?
Thank you so much for having me.
Well, I'm glad to have you on our show. And your book that is called Marrying Outside of God's Will. Can you tell us what inspired you to write this book?
So it was a God-given assignment. While I was married, towards the end of the marriage, I kept saying that I was going to write a book called Marrying Outside of God's Will. And I wasn't really sure because my ultimate goal is to become an attorney. Being an author wasn't part of my plan. And after the divorce and after everything that happened, I was on the prayer line. And this prophet told me that I needed to stop starting and stopping writing my book, that there were souls waiting for it. And I needed to write the book. That way God could publish it, and I needed to put everything in there to stop taking certain details out. And I just started crying because nobody knew that I was writing it. So I knew that was nothing but God. And from that day forward, I just, like, started writing and didn't stop until I was done.
Wow. Well, that is powerful. I know there are some things that are in there that are very personal and difficult to say, and I'm pretty sure that's what you were afraid of, but there are so many women like myself and others that we can relate to those things because we've had them happen to us. And can you tell us a little bit about your past and what led up to the book?
So I was in a domestic violence relationship, which in some aspects of it, I was the aggressor, or sometimes he was the aggressor. I battled with suicide, with depression, with poverty, with homelessness. And all of this was going on while I was in that 12-and-a-half-year relationship. And I was also trying to find that my spot, like my relationship with God. I was trying to figure all that out. And in doing so, you know, life kind of happened, and I made some good choices, some bad choices, and I knew that I was marrying outside of God's will because right before we got married, I prayed and God told me not to marry him. And I was just kind of like, you know, I deserve the title wife. If he's going to marry anybody, it should be me. After everything that I've been through with him, I deserve to be a wife, which is true. I did deserve to be a wife, but I didn't deserve to be his wife.
Right. Wow. So did you, at any point in time, when did you decide, like, okay, this is not where I need to be? What was that kind of aha moment?
So the arguing and fighting got so bad that I wanted to kill myself instead of having to deal with him. But I knew that I couldn't do that because at the time I had 8 sons. And I kept telling him, like, if you don't stop what you're doing, I'm going to leave. And he would tell me, like, oh, I don't care. I have other females and this and that and this and that. So one day I got off of work and I came home. And as soon as I walked in the door, he started cussing me out. And I was just like, I can't take this anymore. And I grabbed all the kids and I told them to get in the car. I didn't pack anything. I didn't take clothes. I didn't take diapers. I literally just took the kids. And he came out to the car, and he was trying to stop me from getting in the car. And it was nothing but God, as close as he was to the car, that I was able to maneuver around him with my baby in my hand, get in the car, put the baby in the car, and lock the door before he was able to grab the door handle and drove
off. Wow. Yeah, because you got to put the baby in the car seat, so I can imagine. You know, he had plenty of time to, so yes, you were protected, definitely. Wow.
Yeah, so I took the kids and I left the family residence, and I never went back.
Wow. So what did you do differently after that? I mean, how did you feel?
When we first left, I was spooked because when I was, like, telling the kids, let's go, we were in the hallway, and he looked me in my face, and his eyes were bloodshot red, so I know it wasn't him. And he was just like, if you ever come back here, I'm going to take you in our room, and I'm going to kill you. So if you leave, you better stay gone. And, you know, he made threats to me previously, but it didn't bother me. Like, I was just like, okay, whatever. But this threat, it shook me to the core. So spooked. Like, I would see him, the kids play sports, and he would come up to the field. And every time I would see him, I would be spooked. So once I got out of that feeling, I kind of felt like when it was all said and done and the divorce was final and I got the paperwork in the mail, I felt like a failure. I felt how come I couldn't be the wife that he needed me to be? How come he couldn't be the husband that I needed him to be? Like, what was wrong with me that in the way it had to end? And at the time, I was battling with abandonment issues. So the thought of, you know, being by myself, even though I had the kids, I was still technically by myself. It was scary. It was really a scary moment for me. That was why I stayed in the relationship as long as I did, because I was afraid of being by myself.
Yes, that is one of the biggest things I think women say when they ask, well, why didn't you leave? And that's the number one thing. They don't want to be alone. And they think that once they do leave, they are going to be alone, that no one else is going to love them enough or want to be with them, because now they have these children and all these other responsibilities. And they just think, okay, well, I'm just not going to have anyone. And a lot of that is, it is scary when you're on your own, especially when you've got small children. And I did not have eight, but oh my goodness, that's got to be even more, you know. And they're all boys. And you know, some men are about boys that are not theirs. So.
Right.
Wow.
And you know, that thing, that's one thing that he used to always tell me, oh, you got all these kids, no one's going to want you, and so on and so on and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And for a long time, I believed it, but I'm remarried, and you know, my husband accepts all of my children. We have a daughter together. Actually, my oldest son is his as well. But we didn't find that until like recently. So when when he first came back into my life, my current husband is my first love. He knew I just had eight sons. And he always knew that the oldest one, there was a possibility, but he didn't know for sure. So he came in knowing, okay, she has eight sons, and this is the package deal, and this is what I'm going to deal with. And there's a lot of men that do not have a problem being with a woman that has children.
Yes. And on the other shoe of that is, you know, there are some guys who seek out women with children because they, in a perverse way. So, and all those things are kind of scary when you're looking at that. You know, like, why is this guy really like me? I mean, or if he's looking at my kids a certain way. It's like, you have eight sons and I had four daughters. And so I had to really be aware, hyper aware when I was trying to date again, because, you know, they could be looking at my children. If they looked at my children wrong, that was it. It's like, it didn't matter how much I liked them, I'd have to kick them to the curb, you know, because I had daughters to protect. But yeah,
right.
That is tough.
When I first started dating again, my children, like, I take them to a friend's house, or I'd go outside the house. Like, there was no contact. They knew I had kids, but they were not allowed to be around them. They were not allowed to see them, because my thing was, I don't know who you are. I'm trying to get to know you. You don't need to get to know my children. You need to get to know me. I don't know where this is going to go or what's going to happen. And my kids do not need to go on the roller coaster ride. And I thank God for my husband, because, you know, I know him. I know his values. I know his morals. He was my first love. We stayed in contact throughout the year. So it was like he wasn't a stranger. He didn't necessarily know my children, but he wasn't a stranger to me. So I felt comfortable having him around my children. But other people that I had talked to before he came, I was just like, oh, no, that's not going to happen.
Yes, definitely. So you said you were wanting to be an attorney. Did that dream come to fruition? Or?
I am currently working on my bachelor's degree in criminal justice. I'm almost done. And then after that, I'll be going to law school.
Wow. So that's a great career. I know it's kind of difficult when you get children and trying to go to school at the same time. So how does that work for you? What is your day like a typical day for you?
So my older six children usually don't bother me unless they want something. My oldest is 13, so I have 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, and then I have 4, 3, and 1.
Oh, wow.
So the older six, they basically, like, kind of do their own thing. You know, they wake up, brush teeth, wash face, come down and eat in their own world unless they get to bickering amongst each other. Or they want, like, oh, Mom, can I go to the store? Can I go to my friends? Or can I? Type of thing. Besides that, they don't too much bother me. My little three, on the other hand, you know, they always have a question. My three-year-old and my four-year-old, they always want to ask me something. My three-year-old, he's so cute. He'll be like, Mommy, I have to tell you something. And I'm like, what? He's like, you're my mommy. And I'm like, I know, you're my son. And then he'll laugh and run away. The first time he did that, I was like, that's so weird. But now that he keeps doing it, I'm like, okay, whatever, however you want to conversate, that's fine. And my daughter is like my shadow. Every step I take, she's right behind me, and she's walking now. She just turned one on the 18th, and she's into everything, and she's like the little boss lady of the house. And
oh, yeah.
It's a wonderful experience. So when I have her occupied is when I start doing work, or if she's like taking a nap or whatever. But when she's up, she's like full on. She has to have my attention. If she notices me doing anything, she'll come and like literally grab my hands or pull my face towards her. She has to have all the attention.
Well, she's the only girl. She's like, okay, you're the only female here besides me, so you need to be right here.
Yeah.
So how are your boys? Yeah. Do they like to play with her or try to kind of take her off your hands sometimes? Or
so they love their little sister. Like, they told my husband if we had a boy that he had to go because there can't be too many boys in the house. So they're, like, super overprotective of her. And my husband's very protective. So he doesn't like for her to be outside of mine or his eyesight. So the boys can't take her too far. But they always want to play with her. And then my little ones, because, you know, she has all these cute little toys. And she's the only girl. And she just has all this stuff. So they're always trying to play with her toys, but now that she can walk, she gets mad and she, like, snatches it from them and tells them no. But they're enjoying her as much as I am.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, wow, she's so... just, she was born and literally took over.
She's going to be mama number two eventually. She's going to have a hard time when she tries to date. She's got a lot of brothers to get through.
They tell her all the time, you're not going to have a boyfriend. You're not going to have a boyfriend. And I'm like, you guys don't know, especially you older ones, by the time that age comes, you're going to be outside the house working or in college or something. So you guys are just talking.
Wow. Yeah, I can imagine it, but they'll probably still check in on her. Or the minute she says something, oh, no, who is this man? Who are you talking to?
Yeah, my oldest son wants to be a professional baseball player, and he keeps telling me that, you know, when he makes it, he's going to come and get her, and she's going to live with him, and his security is going to watch her, so she's not going to have a life. And I'm like, why do you think that I'm going to let my only daughter come and live with you? That doesn't even make sense.
Or he can keep an eye on her, right?
Yeah. Wow. So his security can watch her while he's busy.
Yeah, they can't watch her 24/7. That's the thing about girls, though. So they figure out. Yeah, that tug of war. Wait, when she gets to be a teenager. Yeah. I've already had the whole the stare down, the, you know, I'm grown too, and oh boy.
Wow. See, I'm scared about that part because I'm dealing with the teenage life of my son. My oldest is about to be 14, and the one under him is turning 13. So I'm already dealing with the voice change and the attitude change and the taller than me and I'm just like, yes. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, my youngest is 14. He'll be 15 in September. And yeah, he's taller than everybody. And I have two daughters who are very tall, but he's taller than they are. So now it's like he's the baby, but everybody looks up to him, literally.
Right, right.
He got that little stash, the little mustache. He calls it, you know, that little peach fuzz.
Mm-hmm. I remember when my oldest son first got hair under his arm, and he was so much, it was peach fuzz. It was barely even viewable. And he's like, Mom, guess what? And I'm like, what? What happened? He's like, look. And I'm looking, and I'm like, I don't see anything.
Oh, no.
He's like, Mom, it's right there. And finally I see, like, this baby little hair. And I was like, yeah, I see it. He's like, Mom, I'm a teenager now. And I said, oh, my God.
Yep. So I was like, I have hair everywhere now. I was like, yes, you've had hair everywhere. That's going to happen. You're going to get more as you get older.
Mhm. That's where he's at now. He's like telling his brothers, well, I'm a teenager and you guys are little kids because I have hair everywhere. And I'm like, oh, my gosh, why?
Oh, yeah.
Why
that's
do they
start? They start really feeling themselves, yes. I'm a man now, Ma. I got hair now. It's like, mm-hmm, you got BO too. Yeah. Deodorant. Quick.
Yeah.
At that middle school age. Ooh.
I'm buying deodorant for at least 5 of my kids now. And I know right away, I'm like, dude, go shower and put deodorant on. Because, you know, they're all active and they like to play basketball and the trampoline and.
Right.
They're all into different activities, but they're into activities. So they don't understand once you play activities, you need to go clean up. And one will just lift the arm, and I'm like, oh, you just killed the whole house. Go take a shower.
Yes. Remember those days? I mean, for both boy and girl. It doesn't matter. Lift that arm and that's it.
I'm just really enjoying this stage that we're at right now. You know, teenagers, mm-hmm. fresh teenagers coming. My little ones are a little bit bigger toddlers, and my baby girl is trying to talk and mumbling a lot, but walking around a little Miss Boss Baby. So I'm really enjoying it.
That's too precious, little Boss Baby. I can see that. I can totally picture that because she's got all these boys to play with. She's like, nope, not having it.
Yeah,
I'll
line them up and from oldest to youngest, and like if they get in trouble, so I'm like, okay, family mm-hmm. meeting. And the last time I did it, she grabbed the belt off the couch and she walked up to my 4-year-old and she was pointing at him and she was like, ah, la, 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 and she tried to hit him with the belt. And he's like, Mom! Genesis, she's trying to whoop me.
Well, she knew you called the meeting, so she just knew somebody was getting a whooping, so she's going to do it herself.
Yeah.
Yep, she's going to, yep, she's trying to follow what you, whatever you do. Oh, poor boys. I was going to say poor girl, but poor boys. Wow. So tell us, how did the kids react with everything that was going on with you and your first husband?
At first, it was scary for them. And then, unfortunate to say, it became a routine. It was like they got used to it after a while.
Mm-hmm.
And then as they got older, it was kind of like, you're not going to talk to my mom like that. You're not going to be disrespectful to my mom, or don't put your hands on my mom, or, you know. So
mm-hmm.
the way they felt about it evolved as time got on. And I thought, okay, I can't leave him. You know, my sons can't grow up without their dad because I can't teach them how to be a black man in this society because I'm a woman.
Right.
And I've never been a man. I can teach them morals. I can teach them values. I can teach them respect. But how to actually be a black man in this society is something that I cannot do. So that was mm-hmm. one of my biggest things by knowing him, because, you know, he has children by someone else, is that once the relationship is over, for the most part, he doesn't keep a good relationship. And I didn't want my children not to have that. But then I
right.
learned after the fact that my kids are like, you should have been left.
Hmm.
So I'm thinking I'm yeah. doing them a favor. And they're like, Mommy, we don't know why you stayed and you were dealing with that. We're okay.
Yeah, they're pretty resilient. My first husband, my daughter was 4, and she said, Mom, we could always go live with Grandma. We don't have to stay here. I mean, she was 4. So she figured this out. Okay, we can go live somewhere else. We don't need to stay here. For
wow.
4 girls say that to you, that's something, you know, it makes you think. And kids are pretty resilient. They really are. And they can see, you know, they do not like to see their mother hurt at all. Because you're mom.
Right.
Their whole world. Exactly. You know, and I hate to say that, not that mothers' jobs are more important than fathers, but we are the key nurturers. So, you know, when they get upset or they get hurt or sick, they don't call dad. They call mom. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, unfortunately, dad gets the, you know, bad part of that. But ultimately, mom is the one that's going to take care of them. So, of course, I wouldn't want mom to be hurt, you know. But that is good that they really only adapt to that.
Yeah. I'm learning, and even now in my relationship, my husband, one of the things that I really respect about him is that, you know, even when we have our disagreements, because, you know, no relationship is perfect.
Exactly.
It's not a disrespectful disagreement. Like, I'm not a B word, or my husband calls me Queen. And if he gets mad at me, he calls me Francis. So that is
wow.
the bit of the wording. So going
mm-hmm.
from being in arguments and fights and, you know, your name is B, 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 to Queen is your name, and then when he gets angry, it's Francis, it's a whole different aspect. And
that's a very
you know,
good
my
thing,
sons
yeah.
like my sons tell him like they respect him for the they respect him for that he doesn't disrespect me in that regard.
Yes, because that's pretty tough to do, especially when you are angry with someone. And the fact that he is, you know, conscious about saying or calling you out of your name, that's amazing. It's usually not what most men do. I mean, my husband's never called
mm-hmm.
me anything but his African Queen or his chocolate truffle. But just, I mean, that's what he does. But he has never, even when he's angry with me, he doesn't call me anything like that either. So those are very rare. So you have a great, you know, you have a good one. Because an argument is easy.
Yeah.
I know I am not. When I'm upset, everything will fly out. I can't help it. I try, I'm really trying to get, you know, better at it. I don't curse quite as much as I used to, but yeah, every day, I, you know, it's like, okay, well, as long as I'm making progress, I'm doing okay. So I will try not to call names, but usually that's the first thing you, because you're angry. So I think
right.
until my, you know, it's like, I actually respect how people can be angry and not say or fly off the handle. I respect that because it is difficult to do that. Saved or not.
That's very true because hurt people hurt people. So, you know, when,
yes.
you're, when I'm not going to say you, most people, and I am guilty of this as well, and I'm learning to change, but when anger comes in, it's like I'm going to say, you know, the thing to tear them down or to hurt
right.
them because I'm hurt. Or to try to get my point across. And after the fact, you still love the person. You can't take back the words that you've said. The
exactly.
damage is done. And you know, words are worse than a scar. A scar, a bruise, it'll heal, it'll go away. Words, you can replay them in your head. And you can, oh, mm-hmm. I can't believe they said that to me. And it's
and that's going to stick with them, yeah.
Yes.
Yes, I had to learn that same thing in dealing with my children. It's, you know, when you get upset and you say things, and I had to learn, you know, nope, can't just say that. And they're like, Mom, do you really think I'm that way? You know, and that kind of hurt when they asked me that. I'm like, no, I was just angry. But I apologized to them because it was just flown out. Couldn't take it back. And you're right. My eldest daughter, for a long time, she thought I thought she was stupid or something from some of the things. And I had to ask for her forgiveness because I didn't realize that's what was happening, that I was causing that in her, that made her insecure. And you're right. You can't take it back.
Yeah. So I try, you know, I have my sons, and my thing is that the society we live in, society's already going to try and tear them down. So
yes.
I try not to tear them down. I try to speak life into them, speak life into my husband. And even my daughter, I tell her every day, you're beautiful, you're successful, you're intelligent. Because my thing is with her, if she ever has those dark moments that I had, and she can't even look in the mirror. Maybe she can hear my voice and me telling her, you're
yes.
beautiful, you're intelligent, you're successful. Because I didn't have that. You know, what stops me from committing suicide is God telling me that he would never leave me nor forsake me.
Mm-hmm.
If God didn't do that, I probably wouldn't be here right now.
Yes.
So I always
I believe
try
that.
To give her tools, you know what I mean? So in
mm-hmm.
those dark moments, maybe it'll pop up. Maybe, you know, it'll be a reminder to her.
Yes. That's good. I like that. And that kind of gives her that assurance and confidence. But even though you're telling her that, but that also, because that's what you believe, she'll start believing that about herself.
Mm-hmm.
Because we do have that effect on our children.
Yes.
For good and for bad, you know.
That's true. I strongly believe that, you know, we're responsible for the next generation. And, you know, with my sons, I have a rule in my house. If I can see your underwear, that's a whooping. I do not allow them to call each other the N-words. I don't let allow anybody else to call my kids the N-word. I'm not
yes.
raising no ninjas. You guys are all going to grow up and be successful black men.
Yes. I like that. Yes, definitely. Especially with what's been going on. And I think everything's been kind of brought to light since George Floyd, and to see, you know, that we do need to build up our sons, because they're going to have
mm-hmm.
to deal with, you know, a world that is not necessarily, you know, going to give them a chance. Not everyone
right.
is going to tear them down, but they're, you know, they have to be aware that not everyone is their friend either.
That's true.
So tell
true.
Us how you were able to get past what you went through and what was kind of like a breakthrough for you when you decided, you know, that you wanted to get married again.
That's an interesting story. So me getting married again was I wanted to keep my promise to God. A situation happened with my husband, and I basically, you know, begged God to fix it for him. And I told him, if you fix this, I promise you we're going to live right, and we're going to get married. So when he fixed the situation and my husband was home, I told him, okay, so he was like, oh, we're going to get married, we're getting this, we're getting that. And I'm just like,
mm-hmm.
okay. So he came home and he kept saying, we're going to get married, but I got to get the right ring and I have to get this and I have to get that. And I just kept thinking of my promise to God. Like,
mm-hmm.
you know how your natural parents, they'll loan you money and you're like, I promise on this day I'm going to pay you back.
Right.
So I'm just like,
visualizing, like, oh, goodness, I made this promise. I have to keep it. So then I said, let me take all the pressure off of you. Why don't you just marry me? And then he texted me back and said, okay. So after the situation was fixed and all that stuff, I told him I was leaving the house, and he was standing in the driveway. And I said, I made an appointment at the courthouse on this day at this time for us to get married. All you got to do is show up. And I drove off. And he had this confused look on his face. Wow. Like, what the heck just happened? So I got home. And, you know, I'm nervous. And he's like, oh, we have to talk about this. And I'm making dinner. And I said, okay, so you want me to call the council? And he's like, wait. You don't want to marry me already? We haven't even got married yet. I said, so what do we have to talk about? Well, what are we going to wear and who's going to come? And I said, oh, okay. So that's why I said it's a funny story, because my thing was I had to keep my promise to God, and I didn't care about the perfect proposal, and I didn't care about, you know, the perfect this and the perfect that. My thing
right.
was I told God I was going to do something, and I wanted to do it. Just do this so we can be right, and then God will take care of everything else later. And if we want to later, we can have a big old wedding. But my thing is, I have to be in his will. Like, I lived outside
exactly.
of his will for 12 and a half years, and I refuse to live that way again. And when we got married, when I tell you the blessings came in like a floodgate,
wow.
I'm still amazed at God.
Yes. I believe it, because he does open doors when we are when we stay in his will and we do what he says, even sometimes if we don't want to, or it feels like he's asking us too much, he always makes a way. And
mm-hmm.
it always is for what we need.
Yes.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. That's,
yes.
that's awesome. Because I know he has everything
yes.
lined up. We don't know at all. We think we know. But we really don't know, because
mm-hmm.
only he knows what we can handle. He knows what we're going to learn, because he knows what we're going to do before we do it. So why do we keep doing this, you know? But I think I'm going to do this, or I don't know if I can deal with that, you know, or I can't deal with this. When really, he already knows that we can deal with it. We may not know or feel it, but he knows. And he knows what we need. He might be holding on to something real, whereas I think it was a story that I saw that about the little girl and the pearls, and her dad was, she loved those little pearls, but her dad said, I have something for you. He says, but you got to give me those pearls.
Mm-hmm.
And she was kind of scared. He was like, wait, but I like these pearls. You know, there's this cute little fake pearls. So finally she gives it to her dad, and he gives her real pearls. So when we're finally
wow.
ready to give up what we think is the greatest thing, you know, God's holding something even better in his hand. But we have to be willing to let go of what we think
yes.
or what we know. And when we do that, it's like, wow. Dude, I should have got rid of
there
a long time
a,
ago. What was I waiting for, you know?
Right. There was a picture on Facebook, and
mm-hmm.
it was God, and he was kneeling down to this little girl. And she had a little bitty bear in her hand, and he, like, had his hand out for her to give it to him. But behind his back, he had this huge bear.
Mm-hmm.
And under it, it said something like, you know, to us, it's big, but to God, it's small. And he asked us, you know, to let it go. And we're afraid, and we don't want to, but then he has
right.
something huge in store for us.
That's exactly right. I really like that. And I know it's hard, because we think, okay, there's nothing, you know, but when he says, you know, there is nothing impossible for him, and we need to trust him, we really do.
Mm-hmm.
Because we really can trust that he will do what he said he's going to do, because I would not be here. There's too many times I could have, 2 years ago, I could have died 3 times. I was that close to death. So knowing.
Wow.
that he can pull me from something that would have killed anyone else. You know, I have no choice. I have to say,
mm-hmm.
you know, if not for him, I would not be here. And so, you know, it doesn't matter. I may not be the most spiritual person in the world or whatever, but he can use anybody and anything. And if he wants you to do something, And when you say yes, you know, you say, okay, here you go.
Yes. Yes, that's the key. It's saying yes, because, you know, God's not going to force himself or force anyone to live right or to live according to his will. It's
right.
Kind of like, wow, God, he's ministering to me right now. So it's kind of like us as parents, and we want our children to have a good life and to do the right things. And, you know, they want to go and they want to do and do crazy
right.
stuff. And we're like, no, just do right. But what I always tell my kids, like when I get on them about brushing their teeth and their hair and all these things, how do I benefit from you brushing your teeth? I have my own teeth in my mouth.
Mm-hmm.
I don't benefit from that. That's something that you have to, you know, live with. So
yes.
It's kind of like God's like, you have to live this life, and I want you to have a good life, but you're so hard-headed.
Yes, convince we know more. I don't know what makes us think we know more. I really don't get that. It's like, what was I thinking? This is the creator of the universe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay, but I know what I'm doing. No, we don't. and I will tell you,
right.
I do not know what I'm doing. Nope. It's a step of faith every time I wake up, because I could be gone.
Most definitely.
So it's, you know,
most
I can't
definitely.
Say, well, that's why I say Lord willing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
If I say I want to do something in the future, I say, well, Lord willing, that's what, you know, because I can, I'm, you know, tomorrow's not promised. So every day I get up, say, okay, thank you for waking me up today, because if you didn't want me to wake up, I'm not waking up. Let me think about that. But most people don't look at it that way. They take for granted waking up every day. We take for granted being able to use our hands and legs or doing things. And when you don't have it and you can't use it, you realize how important it was.
Right.
Because I've been in a
so
wheelchair
true.
Twice. It's not fun.
Wow.
I will tell you, I didn't think I was going to walk, you know, but honestly, God kept saying, I'm going to heal you. I said, okay. I kept seeing things get worse and worse, but he kept saying, you're already healed. And I'm thinking, okay. All right. I trust you. I'm healed. So I just started saying I'm healed. And eventually I got out of that chair. So I know he can do it.
Yes, God can do everything but fail.
Yes. Now, we can fail, but he can use our failures, actually, as well, even though we think, you know, nope, I messed it up. I did the wrong thing. There's no way I'm coming out of this.
Mm-hmm.
But he always sends somebody. Did you have anyone helping you when you first, when you left?
Yes, actually, I went to a friend's house. It was like it was time for me to leave the situation. God already had a support system ready for me. And when I made the call and I was kind of like, I left. Can I come stay at your house? Mind you, I'm bringing 8 kids with me. Every
right.
door that I knocked on and I asked was open to me, no problem.
Wow.
So I had a wonderful support system, and I'm thankful to those ladies and men that helped me along the way. And it wasn't easy, and, you know, it was hard, and, you know, of course, there were those moments when it was like, I want to go back, or maybe we can work it out. But now that I am out of it, and I
mm-hmm.
am on the other side, it's like I feel like everything that I went through was necessary, and I'm grateful.
Yes. I believe that's true. 'Cause when you go through something like that, and to have him open up the doors for you, when you finally let go and you said, okay, I'm going to trust you, and I'm going to leave out of this situation, and he had so many things for you. You know, I was reading, you know, that what you mentioned in the book. So tell me a little bit about your ministry and how you help others. Because I was looking at your website, which is really nice. It's really pretty.
It's called God's Will Ministries. And I use it to basically motivate, to inspire people, to let them know they're not the only one, they're not alone, and that if God can do it for me, he can do it for you. He's not a perspective of person. I have transparency every Tuesday, 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, and I discuss a different, what I like to call, behind-the-scenes battle. I've talked about domestic violence. I've talked about homelessness. I've talked about failure as a parent. I've talked about separation from a child's point of view. I had one of my sons on with me. I recently talked about what is, what was, or what will be your enough. So every Tuesday, God gives me a different topic to speak about. And, you know, just letting people, because, you know, no one wants to admit that they're hurting or they're in pain or they're depressed, suicidal, or they're in a domestic relationship. These are all things that people don't want to talk about. It's not really talked about in the church. So since I've been through it, I've lived it, and I've survived it, I'm going to talk about it.
Yes.
And the hope.
We should.
It helps somebody else. It's inspiring to someone else. It gives motivation to somebody else.
Yes, because they know, well, she got it. She got out of there, and she's doing well now. So, you know, that means I can do it too. Because some people feel like they're alone in their situation. And it is difficult. And because depression is a very, very sneaky, sneaky spirit that just comes right at you. In a way that just kind of slips in, and over time, you're like, when you lose hope, that's when that sets in.
Right. And then another thing, too, is that a lot of these topics are mental health issues. Mm-hmm. And in the African-American community, mental health is not, it's like something that nobody wants to talk about or to admit that they need help with. You know, we're taught to tell anybody what's going on in your home.
Yes.
Or if you're a boy, you're not supposed to cry. Or you're not supposed to tell anybody your business. So people are literally silently dying and afraid to ask for help. And the cycle continues because that's what they teach their children.
Yeah. Unfortunately, it does get passed down. And if you tell anyone you're seeing a therapist or anything, it's a real stigma in the African community. It's just it's not something we do. You know, you just got to tough up and deal with it. And we always say that, well, we do what we have to do.
Right.
Yeah, but we have to realize it's okay. It's like, yeah, I need help. I can't, I'm having a hard time with this. I need help.
And judgment has a lot to do with it as well. People are so judgmental people are afraid to even ask for help because they're afraid of being judged or being talked about. Or being subbed on social media. It's like the world is so cruel. There's no one really has a heart anymore. What happened to checking on your friend or, you know, making sure they're okay or the single mom that, you know, let me go over there and see if she needs help with her laundry or maybe I'll take them dinner tonight. Mm-hmm. Everyone is all about themselves. Selfish, you know, they won't even lend a hand, as in if you learn something new and the next person's trying to learn it, oh, no, I can't tell you what I learned. This is a whole world.
I know. That is.
And it's enough for everybody.
Or maybe sometimes they're also jealous and it's like, well, you know, if I teach you, you might do better than me. That seems to happen in the community a lot. Exactly.
Yeah.
That I can open up doors for you, you know, by you teaching me something, you don't know what I can bring to your situation. But if you're not open to it, you're going to miss out on a blessing that could have been right there for you.
And no one can steal what God has for you. What's for you is for you.
It's
just
for you.
Because you help the next person, doesn't mean that they're going to steal your blessing.
No.
Because
and by
like
helping
God
them,
yeah. You have something for them.
Something for them. Mm-hmm. And he says, when you do it for the least of these, you're doing it for me. And when we do things, we should always think, you know, because he would do it. We never know who we're helping when we do that. If we just, you know, stop being afraid to reach out to people.
Don't even know it.
Unaware. Exactly. Yep. I forgot which scripture that was, but I know there I know there is one. I said you could be entertaining angels unaware. Exactly.
Yep. But no one thinks about that. No one, you know, like I said, it's just so much selfishness and hatred and jealousy and envy in the world. It's crazy.
Yes. And this is a time we should become the other. And it does make my heart happy to see more people standing up and protesting, you know, not looting and rioting, but standing up together for something positive and not using it as an excuse to go act a fool.
Right.
Because we
can't,
you know, there's a huge, huge difference. You want to affect change. We don't have to burn down the building to do that. We really don't.
Or steal or break a building or, you know, these are people's businesses that they work so hard to put up and they don't have anything
to
do with what's going on.
And why they always burn buildings in their own community? So you want to steal from the person who has been, in your community actually has a store for you, run by someone who looks like you, but you want to destroy that store because you're mad at the police who have nothing to do with that store.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't make sense to me. But yeah, and
no,
I'm
whatsoever.
Glad that, you know, it is crazy to see how much everyone from other countries have been really supportive. And that's, and I wish they were here, you know, that would, that love and that wanting to, you know, would be here. But I know that God has a reason for all these things too. And that's why I got to trust him in this situation. Because I know that even though he's allowing the enemy to have his little run, but it's for a reason. So I know that something good is going to come out of it because we never stay down long at all. No race of people anywhere. Mm-hmm. They've always come out of it. So you just got to hang in there. So tell us where do you sell the book? You said, I think I saw it on their website. It's actually on your website too. They can buy your book.
The link that's on my website is where they can PayPal me to purchase a book from, like an autographed copy from me.
Okay.
But the book is on Amazon. It's on Barnes & Noble's. It's on Walmart.com. It's on IndieBound. If you have an Apple or a Google product, you can download the book from the Apple Store or the Google Bookstore.
Nice. Awesome. And again, we are talking with author Francis Dupree, who is also a minister and has God's Will Ministries is her website, and you can find her book, Marrying Outside of God's Plan, on Amazon and you said other places?
Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Walmart.com, Apple Store, Google Bookstore, Marrying Outside of God's Will. I've made it available as many places as I can.
Nice. Do you ever think you'll make it like an audiobook for people who, you know, are busy and they don't have time to sit down and read? Because I think
it
would be a powerful. Yes. Awesome. I think it would be great for people to really be able to hear and in your voice and your words from you. Especially, I love that for nonfiction authors who I think them telling their story, especially for something like this. I think that would be really powerful impact.
Yeah, I'm in the process of making it audio. It's already ebook and paperback, but now I'm in the process of audio, and I'm working on a few other things in regards to the book too. So stay connected so you don't miss out on anything. That God's doing big things with this book and with the ministry, so make sure you guys tune in.
And can you tell us your Facebook or other social media links that you have where they can contact you or follow you?
My Facebook is Frances Dupree. My YouTube channel is Frances Dupree. My Instagram is MRS_9 the hard way. And my Twitter is at Ms. Lady Dupree.
Nice. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show tonight. And I know it's been a blessing just talking to you and hearing your story and hearing you say it and reading your words as well. And I'm going to continue reading because I'm not done with the book yet, but I'm going to continue reading it. And I highly recommend it. So my little deal is Mahogany says, pick up this book, read it, learn it, share it with others, because you will be blessed by it. And someone who out there who needs to know they are not alone. And even if we do things outside of God's will, there he always makes a way for us because he knows what we're going to do. So is there anything you have as far as advice for young women that you would like to tell them?
My advice is when a person shows you who they are the first time to believe it, don't make excuses for them. And also don't give up. Don't worry about your past. Don't be ashamed of it. You have to have a test in order to have a testimony. Nobody's life is perfect. When you're crying out to God, he hears you. And most times your blessing is literally right there. Don't get distracted. Don't get discouraged. Keep pushing.
Yes. All right. Well, thank you, everyone, for tuning in to the Mahogany Says show. We have been talking with author Frances Dupree. And I thank you for being on the show. And I hope that everyone has a wonderful evening. Blessings, peace, and love to you all. And remember to always love yourself and love others. Have a good evening, everyone.
Been listening to Mahogany Says with Mahogany Silverain at mahoganysilverain.net. Thank you and good night.